God. The Bible can certainly be described as God's self-revelation to His people. It is critical to remember that the Bible demonstrates that even our knowledge of God is limited and finite, whereas God is infinite, pure, and a living personal spirit whom no one has seen. The Bible frequently employs words and ideas derived from human activities and emotions in an attempt to help us better understand God. These can be very useful, but applying descriptions and terms normally applied to humans to an infinite and eternal God will always leave something to be desired. However, knowing God to the extent that we are able through His Word in Scripture is at the heart of biblical faith. According to the Bible, all people throughout history have had some sort of relationship with God, whether it was one of rebellion and disbelief, or one of acceptance and faith in Him. Men and women are here on earth because of God's creating and sustaining power, and the Bible teaches that at the end of time, all will have to face Him for judgment. The nature of God and His attributes are thus discussed in a variety of ways in Scripture in order for those to whom He will hold accountable to be better acquainted with Him, as He is seen acting in history for the support and protection of His people, as well as in judgment on those who sin or live in rebellion against Him. Much is also learned about God from the names He has given in the Bible. As His creation is discussed and examined, much is learned. Above all, we learn about God as we study the biblical teaching on Jesus, who is referred to as Emmanuel, or God with us. A lifetime of study, faith, and commitment to God through Christ will still leave the believer yearning for more, particularly Christ's return, because he or she will agree with the Apostle Paul. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known, the existence of the only God. The Bible presupposes God's existence. There is no discussion of this in the book, because it is a book in which God reveals Himself. Psalm 14, verse 1. The fool has said in his heart, "There is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none who does good." Psalm 53, verse 1. The fool has said in his heart, "There is no God. They are corrupt and have done abominable iniquity. There is none who does good." The existence of God is frequently asserted in contexts that caution against idolatry. There is often a strong emphasis here on the fact that God is the only God and that no other God exists. Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Deuteronomy 32, verse 39 says, Now see that I, even I, am He, and there is no God besides me. I kill and I make alive, I wound and I heal, nor is there any who can deliver from my hand. Idolatry is such a serious sin because of this. 1 Corinthians 8, verse 4. As concerning therefore the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is none other God but one. The people of Israel were expected to bear witness to the surrounding nations that there was only one true God and no other gods at all. This was to be seen especially in God's power to provide for them in war and peace, to extend their borders against the power of other so-called gods, and in His justice and judgment on all who rejected Him, His ways, or His people. The nations around Israel needed to learn from Israel that their gods were false gods, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 20. Rather, that the things with the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God, and I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. The psalmists and prophets also declared that the Lord is the only God, that He pre-exists and self-exists. Psalm 90, verse 2. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Isaiah 44, verse 6. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and His Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Isaiah 45, verse 5. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me. Isaiah 45, verse 21. tell and bring forth your case. Yes, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? Who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no other God besides me, a just God and a Savior. There is none besides me. Jeremiah says in Jeremiah 10, verse 10, But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At his wrath the earth will tremble, and the nations will not be able to endure his indignation. The eternal self-existence of God is assumed once more in the New Testament. John 1, verses 1 to 4. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Paul preached to the Athenians, arguing that in him, God, we live and move and have our being, among other things. Acts 17, verse 28. For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Paul persuaded the citizens of Lystra that they too should acknowledge the existence of the one true God. Acts 14, verse 17. Nevertheless, he did not leave himself without witness, in that he did good, gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. Romans 1, verses 19 to 20. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. For God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen since the creation of the world, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. As mentioned in John 1, learning about Jesus often leads to a greater understanding of God and his pre-existence and self-existence in the New Testament. Colossians 1 verse 17 describes both Jesus' pre-existence as the image of the invisible God and his sustaining work in his creation. Colossians 1 verses 15 to 20. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Both the Father God and Jesus are seen to be eternal in their existence. Revelation 1, verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Revelation 11, verse 15. Then the seventh angel sounded, and there were loud voices in heaven, saying, The kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Revelation 1, verse 17. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, Do not be afraid, I am the first and the last. 2 Peter 3, verse 8. But, beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Hebrews 13, verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Creator God. God's self-existence and external existence are also indicated by his creation, which he brings about ex nihilo, out of nothing. Genesis 1, verses 1 to 5. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, Let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Romans 4, verse 17. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Hebrews 11, verse 3. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. The Bible does not allow for anything existing side by side with God through all eternity. There is no teaching that, for example, matter has always existed or that evil has always existed alongside God. God has always existed and will continue to exist as the Creator. He who exists creates all other things. Reason may demand that if anything exists, it must possess the ability to exist. The Bible demonstrates that the only being who exists is God and God alone. Because he exists, life and creation are possible. Life and light are found in God. From all eternity, he is the only one who has life in himself and dwells in light and glory. The Bible describes God's act of creation numerous times. Notably, Genesis 1-2 describe God's word creating everything we know. These chapters clearly demonstrate that God existed before the creation and that the world came into existence as a result of his creating word and power. They also show that God did not simply initiate a process that ended or is still continuing with what we know in this world today. He actively intervened time and again to create light, the sun, the moon, water, vegetation, fish, mammals, birds, and humanity. This active work of God throughout the entire period of creation is noted in both the words, "And God said, let there be," and the words, "And God saw that it was good," in Genesis 1. The work and words of the Lord God are mentioned several times in Genesis 2. Psalm 33, verses 4-9. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his work is done in truth. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the deep in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast. Psalm 33, verses 4-9, personalizes the word of the Lord as the one who created and who is faithful in all he does. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made. Let all the earth fear the Lord. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. Jeremiah affirms he, God, is the maker of all things, including Israel, the tribe of his inheritance. The Lord Almighty is his name. Praise and worship are due to God the Father and Jesus, the Word of God, for creation and the ongoing maintenance of his creation. Because his creation derives its life and existence from God, it would cease to exist if God were to abandon it. John 1, verses 1-3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. Revelation 4, verse 11. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Colossians 1, verses 16 and 17. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through